again. How is everyone? We are, by the way, I'm gonna be back in here Monday with Dr. Smith's class, so Dr. McKinney, if y'all, this will be an option for you, and I'm bringing my graduate class in here with you, because they start at 4:45, you start at 4:00. So they're coming a little bit early, and I'm doing the first piece of managing difficult people. It's a three-series piece, and I'm gonna be doing one of them, so that's up there, and I'll be with Dr. Smith's group on Monday, correct?
Correct.
And I got 13 graduate students that'll be in here too, so that feel really good. We're very fortunate to have with us two ladies out of Alexander County, and on very short notice, they agreed to come. We have Teresa Smeeks on my far left, is the coordinator of accountability for Alexander County Schools. And there's some other things she'll tell you. Dr. Donna Hebner is a past acquaintance of mine, starts a long time acquaintance.
You're in trouble already.
And she is the interim associate superintendent of Alexander County. And until March 1st, she is the director of elementary curriculum and student services in Title I. I don't know how you do all that, but.
And my name's Jennifer. Okay, I think you said Donna.
I said Donna. Donna's over in Catawba County. I'm sorry. She's been talking to me about coming to our doctoral program, and I had her on my mind. Jennifer and I go back a while. She's an Appalachian person that we met years ago. But we're very fortunate to come talk to you about the core curriculum, and I understand you have some more of that tomorrow, I believe it is, or another group has it tomorrow. Don't think we hear too much of it, because it is the way of life coming for 2012. So as those of you entering the field after this particular semester, then it is that way. And we're gonna turn it over to them, and they'll talk to us a little bit about what it means, what experiences are, and how we implement that in our classrooms. So Jennifer, I'll turn it over to you.
You know Donna?
I wasn't attending. I want to apologize to you in the beginning because I truly don't know a thing about you. I don't know what you know about Common Core and Essential Standards. So if I say something today that you already know, just make note of it. I already knew that, and forgive me for wasting your time. But I do hope that I'll be able to share some things with you that maybe you didn't know, even if it's not until the very end when we start talking to you about assessments and how assessments with this initiative will be very, very different from anything that our students have seen in a long, long time. I always like to tell just a little bit about myself and where I'm from as far as my professional journey. I have been in the Alexander system for, I'm finishing up year 24, and I started at the ground level because I started as a teacher assistant and bus driver. Working on my undergraduate degree at Lenoir-Rhyne at night and on weekends, I've never been a traditional college student. I have never taken the SAT. But I have done some great things, and I've met wonderful people along the way. Met Dr. Urey at Appalachian when I was working on a master's in school administration. I have also completed an EDS at Appalachian, and as of December, graduated with my doctorate from there. And I have worked in a lot of different roles in Alexander County. As I said, started as a teacher assistant and bus driver. Then from there, I was a sixth grade math teacher. From there, an assistant principal, a principal, a director at the central office, and beginning March 1st, I will be an interim assistant superintendent. So it's been a great journey. I've never seen anything quite like what we're going to talk to you about today, but the great news is nobody else in North Carolina has either. Teresa, I'd like for you to tell just a little bit about yourself, and then I want to get a feel for where you are in your program here at Gardner Webb.
My name is Teresa Smeeks, and my story is extremely different. I grew up in Western Kentucky and went to Western Kentucky University for my undergrad. And my first job was in inner city Nashville, Tennessee schools. So it was a huge, from where I grew up to where I went to school. The school I taught in was as big as my hometown. So a little bit of a culture shock there. And I met my husband and married him, and he is a physician. And we started moving from all of his education So I've taught in Tennessee, Ohio, and North Carolina, and I'm licensed in Kentucky. So I've been licensed in four different states. When I got to North Carolina, wasn't going to teach again, couldn't stand it, got back into the classroom, and then went to App State, and my master's in administration supervision is from App State. And my husband moved again and took a job as an administrator at the hospital in Hickory. And I was looking for a job around there and met Dr. Jeff Peel, who does some grad classes for Gardner Webb. He got me into the system. I actually applied for a high school math job, taught math all those years, and they were going to hire me for that. And he and Mr. Hope decided, no, they needed me to head up their AIG program. So they pulled me over, and I worked with AIG in central office. And I did that for 2 years, and they moved me over. When they lost a director's position, they needed someone to do that work without having to pay a director. So I got to be the coordinator. And so I still do testing and accountability. If you have RTI questions, I'm going to get that. I still do all the AIG. Media coordinators fall under me. What have I left out? ESL. Titles 2 and 3 fall under me, so I work with a lot of different programs. If you ever need help, call. I'll do the best I can do, plus anything that Mr. Hope asked me to do, which includes heading up Common Core and Essential Standards with Jennifer and other things. So we're a very small county, very few of us doing a lot of big things. So, and I'm honored to get to work closely with the new interim superintendent and interim assistant superintendent, so that's been really great for me. I do have my degree. I've never been an assistant principal or principal because they kind of skipped me over that, but I had wonderful help and wonderful mentors to learn from, which is, that's if you can get someone like that, that's what you do.
Am I correct in assuming you're in an undergrad program here at Gardner Webb? Mm-hmm. All right, all education majors? Mm-hmm. Yes. How many are planning to go in the elementary setting? Middle school? Aww. High school? Okay, so all for the most part. Did I leave anybody out? Okay, all right, wonderful. Well, my background is elementary for the most part, so hopefully I can shed some insight for you. Common Core and Essential Standards, that is something that we have been hearing about since 2008. That's when it really hit the forefront of what was coming. But beginning next year, it will be referred to as North Carolina's Standard Course of Study. So it will be the same thing, but it will undergo the name change. And not only is this a change in curriculum, but this is a paradigm shift. And I think that you might gain some insight into that as we talk today. You can't just talk the talk. We've got a lot of walking to do. We're going to have to walk the walk, but it very much will involve changing teaching practices and instructional practices if we want our students to be successful. And to this date, I've never met a teacher who looked me in the eye and said, Jennifer, I just really don't want my children to be successful. So we have a lot of things to accomplish in the next couple of years. I want to introduce you today to some vocabulary. All of this, as I said, hit the scene in 2008 with an acronym referred to as ACRE, and that's the Accountability and Curriculum Reform Effort. Then we started hearing acronyms RTTT, or Race to the Top, and I don't know how much you know about that, but North Carolina is one of 16 states who actually received funding for this initiative. And that is part of the Race to the Top. That's what we did. We had to compete for the money that we have received to make this happen. The detailed scope of work is nothing more than every LEA in North Carolina had to complete a plan of action as far as we were given our cut of the money that North Carolina received, and then we had to put on paper how we planned to spend that money to actually implement the Common Core and Essential Standards. NC Falcon got into the mix also, so you might have heard that acronym, and it stands for Formative Assessment Learning Communities Online Network. and some of our principals were very confused. They thought that NC Falcon and Common Core and Essential Standards, that that was kind of one in the same when we first started talking about it, and it's not. The NC Falcon really deals with formative assessment, what it is, how you create them, why they are important, what you need to do when you realize children are struggling after you have administered a formative assessment. So it's very different from the Common Core and Essential Standards. Now, you can actually access anything that we talked about today as far as modules under a website called NC Education. And we have had to work to get all of our individuals a username and password. You wouldn't believe how many times Teresa is called by not only teachers, but also administrators, saying, Teresa, I forgot my password, or I misplaced my password. But you do have to be an educator in North Carolina to actually get the password. But this is really a Moodle site that contains a lot of modules. There are lots of things there, and an online learning module. I'm certain that you know what that is. But the Falcon modules are there, the Common Core and Essential Standards modules are there, and many other items. Even the writing across the curriculum, that's where it all started, when we started having writing modules. And to be honest with you, teachers in North Carolina had not done a lot of online learning before the writing modules were released. And that's when we changed up the writing program in the state. But now we're doing a lot of things online through these modules. And it was a little bit of a challenge for us in the beginning, but I think that we finally have accomplished how to actually log on to NC Education and get to where you need to be on that web page and access the module that you have to complete, because we do give our teachers and administrators a timeline of when they need to complete certain things to make sure that they have been exposed to some very important information.
Jennifer, our instructors can get on there now, so even though these people can't create their site, we can show it to you.
Okay.
You can actually use it. We heard from a gentleman with Independent Colleges just this week with a permission to do that. So if we haven't shared that, we will. I created mine day before yesterday. They'll have access.
If they can see it, it's wonderful. And the thing I want to tell you, and this is no joke, Teresa and I, we've been working with principals for some time now. We actually have gone through some of the modules with them step by step. And I know you're thinking, well, why in the world would you do that? But for administrators, it's been a pretty big shift also to go online and complete these things. But we worked with them during a principal's meeting on a Tuesday, and when I went back onto the website to check on something, everything had been rearranged, and this was on Thursday. So what it looked like 2 days before had changed. And that's been a wee bit of a challenge as well. We've also had some difficulties. Everybody in the state, it seems, on occasion tries to get on some of the same modules. So there have been some technical difficulties, but for the most part, we're working through those. If you get a chance to check out NC Education, please do that and just get an idea of all the things as far as professional development being offered on the site. I did an opening presentation for all personnel in Alexander County in August, and I really wanted them to understand there is a difference in Common Core and Essential Standards. And this slide, a lot of our staff said, Jennifer, it really helped just having the visual. But the Common Core state standards have been adopted by 46 states. And we actually have a map of the U.S. on this presentation, and you'll see the four states who decided not to go with Common Core. But 46 have decided that, and the District of Columbia. But Common Core will refer to English Language Arts and Mathematics. So we will see very, very common learning objectives throughout those 46 states. Now the essential standards, that's everything else, and this is a slide that I used in August. This has changed because as of September, the State Board also approved the guidance standards. So if I had gone back and updated the slide, I would have added that under North Carolina Essential Standards also, because it's everything else. Science, social studies, world languages, arts, healthful living, career and tech ed, exceptional children, ESL, it's everything else, including, as I said, the guidance standards. Now, something that I want you to pay special attention to, English language development and information and technology, you see those in blue. They fall under is North Carolina Essential Standards, and the reason they are in blue is because those should be integrated into everything else. And that's been a wee bit of a shift also, because a lot of what we've been doing with technology, we do it separately, especially at the elementary level, where children go into a computer lab and they work on technology standards. And what we're doing in Alexander County, we're going to quit working that way, because technology should be in everything up there in white. It should not be a subject by itself. So that's why those two particular things are in blue at the bottom. Here we have the map of the United States. Four states decided not to do this. Obviously, Alaska, Texas, Nebraska, and Virginia, believe it or not. So one of our neighbors decided not to. Okay. Now, you're maybe asking, well, you know, what's the big deal? Well, the big deal is, in North Carolina, we were somewhat on a cycle that every 5 years, you could count on having some curriculum changes and textbook adoptions and that sort of thing. But we did it one subject at a time for the most part. One year it was reading, the next year it might be social studies, the next year it might be science, and so on. So that you were on about a 5-year cycle. Well, what is so different about this is that it's everything at one time. So not to scare you as elementary teachers, but can you imagine what they're facing right now? Because what are most elementary classrooms? Most of them are self-contained, where you have teachers teaching all the subjects. So they are having to revamp and redo everything. It's not just one subject across the board for elementary teachers. So we have certainly made a plea for them, because they're digging and they're working really, really hard to make sure that we're ready to make all this happen in August of 2012. If you'll go back 1 second, Teresa. Something else that you will see right here. Here we are, 2011-12. And you see that we're going to teach the current standard course of study. Everything stays the same. But in 12-13, it's in green, because here is where we will teach the Common Core and assess it at the same time. And we've never done that either. We've always had somewhat of a transition time where you could kind of get your feet wet with new curriculum and curriculum changes before you had to be tested on them, but not with this. It's all happening simultaneously.
Is that a statewide mandate? Systems can't opt not to do that, right?
Oh, no. And we agreed to some things when we got our Race to the Top funding. And one of the things was that we would do that, that we would roll out and test by a certain time, and the time is quickly approaching. So, all right, Teresa. We are very ambitious in North Carolina, because we are the first state to implement new curriculum, new assessments, and have a new accountability model all at the same time. North Carolina is the first to do that. Now, we're not doing it alone, and it's not something that we've just started. This work started for us in our school system last spring, where we started recruiting a core team of teachers who would help us make this happen. Teresa and I are two people. We have a small rural system of 5,600 children, 10 schools, but still. Did you go back to that slide where it's everything? Math, English language arts, and everything else on the other column. Teresa and I are two people. We knew immediately we couldn't do it alone. So we started talking to principals and we started recruiting teacher leaders who would help us. And we call that team of 16 the core team. Well, from there, the core team has grown into a 42 teacher leader content team. And then from there, a more than 60 teacher leader curriculum mapping team. Because what we are doing is we are training teacher leaders in our system to try to make things happen in every classroom in the school district. So we haven't done it alone. We started officially with a state-mandated summer institute where that core team of 16, they were told, meet at such and such location at such and such time, and we're going to work for 2 days on learning content and coming up with a game plan for how to make this happen in Alexander County. Now, in the day, when there was more funding than we have now, I could look at a teacher leader and say, if you're willing to do this, I can pay you a stipend. Or I can trade a work day with you because it's not fair for you to give up 2 days of your summer break. But we're in a time where that's not a reality. So I had to look at those individuals when they agreed to serve on the core team, and I said, well, we'll have to do work after school in the spring. We have a 2-day summer institute in the summer and then tons of work to do this school year. But I can't really give you anything to compensate you other than I will definitely put it in writing to your principal that on your teacher evaluation, you need very high marks for what you're helping our system do.
Let me ask you, if you would hire one of these young people after August 2012, will you be prepared to train them, or are you expecting them to come in and be ready to join the team? That puts a little obligation back on us, I think.
I don't think that they need to know everything, but the thing that I do think they need to know is that they need to go to teacher leaders in the school and get on board with things such as the new curriculum maps and pacing guides, and make sure that you have those things to have very strong instructional practices where you're very comfortable with technology and different things, and to just be open to being asked to work hard, because we are going to dig. And so do I expect them to be experts with Common Core and Essential Standards? No. But I think that if you already know that you're going into the elementary setting, you do need to be familiar with this new curriculum.
Since they're all elementary, would there be any way we could see some pacing guides maybe before the semester is over?
We get them finished.
We're going to talk about some of this. We'll share anything with you that we create. We have our first day of actually working on curriculum mapping on February 20th. So, and we're going to talk to you just a little bit about that, but I'll share anything with you all that we have available.
Can I add one thing to what they need to do if we were going to hire them? It's not just the standards this time, it's how you teach. And the way I was taught in my undergrad as a math teacher is nothing like the way they're going to expect you to teach math when you get there. It's going to be very student-centered and inquiry-based. If you have any access to investigations, which is a program that goes along in our county, we're going to be using a lot of that in a lot of the counties we've heard from.
But math foundations, where you're working with math practices, that will be very different from the way you were taught to do math.
Reading foundations is a good program. If you get a chance to just hear anyone or go to any of those things, if when you do student teaching, take advantage. We are allowing our student teachers to be a part of all of this. We've invited them. They're going to be in on our curriculum mapping teams. Now, will they have to do something to get a good grade? No. But the opportunity to be there as this is coming out is very helpful for them. So the county that you work in, you're going to ask. They may say no, but a lot of counties will allow you, if you're student teaching there, to be involved in those things.
And so our role as faculty is instruction and assessment. The mapping and the pacing guides will be there when they get a job.
Well, our teachers are
We've actually talked with our curriculum mapping teams, and we may start school in August with just 9 weeks completed. Because we have really pulled back from this. In our system, we are starting to look very deeply at essential questions, deciding what must children learn, the skills that they need to acquire and be able to transfer to all situations, not just a math problem, and that sort of thing. So this has been huge for our system. And we have teachers struggling right now, because can you imagine being a 20, 25-year veteran? And boom, life is, as they have known it, is ending. And sacred cows, all those things that I know that you've talked about in some of your classes, we're dealing with some of that.
I just want you to know, these young adults, most of them are going to be hitting the classroom in the fall.
Okay.
As student teachers. Mm-hmm. And we want them ready. Mm-hmm. So this is really good. Thank you.
Good. Yeah. I want to just say a little more about this. As I said, it formally started throughout the state in July, but we have had checkpoints and different things that we're doing. Tomorrow, Teresa is going to a fidelity check. And what that means is as a region, Alexander is located in the Region 7 area of North Carolina, we meet at our RESA. And we look at our timelines and our plans, and we report out, where are we with being ready to roll all of this out in August? And we talk about that and network. We've started meeting as curriculum and instructional leaders monthly to share. And the good thing that has happened is that I am seeing sharing among systems and districts like I've never seen before. We are publishing things on our wikis. And anything that we have, we slap it up there. Technically, I guess Teresa and I probably ought to post this to the Region 7 Wiki. And telling people, if you can take anything from it that helps you learn or that helps you teach someone else, take it. And but that's what this is all about, is that this is ongoing. We already know that we have another Summer Institute planned. We recently received the dates. But this is ongoing, because we know it's huge, and it will not be picture perfect for August. Our work will continue much into the year next year. Something that has been helpful, and we just slapped up the Alexander County calendar, and you're probably thinking, well, what does this have to do with all this? Something that has been fantastic was that during the summer months, I don't know how much you all heard as far as the politics that were played, but during the summer, this past summer, we went from a 180 school year calendar to a 185. It felt like it was just like boom. Mm-hmm. So we added 5 extra days. They started out as student days, but we were able to apply for a waiver. And in that waiver, it said, if you will allow us to use those 5 extra days as required professional development days, we will ensure that all of our teachers, and as it has turned out, all of our non-certified staff also, but that they will be learning and training, because we need time to get ready for such an initiative. And that was granted. So those 5 professional development days have been a lifesaver for us. The saddest thing is that we're this far in this year, we can already see into next school year, and we need those 5 again. But at this point, we have applied and submitted a waiver, but no word yet. So as of this moment, the 5 days will be student days during the 12-13 school year. So, Teresa and I made a presentation to the state board in January. I put that little plug with our calendar in there for the state board. We'll see what happens. But we need more time, even into next year. There is an ocean of information out there. And the thing that I hear from principals and teachers, Jennifer, I just don't have time to go through and sift through all that stuff, because some of it's good, some of it's not so good, and that has been a problem for us. So we want to show you today some of what's in the ocean that is good. If you don't have DPI's website on your favorites, you need to get it, and get it there soon. It is right here, www.ncpublicschools.org. Then you tack on acre to that, and it will take you to what we're just about to show you. On the acre website, when you hit that link, or when you type in the website including acre, this is what pops up. And it has a page with a lot of stuff on it. But we want you to see that right here we have Common Core State and NC Essential Standards. And you can see right here that there are the standards listed on this page. Then from there, we want you to see the difference as far as what it looks like here. These are essential standards, all those other subjects, and they're listed out. Do you know that because we did this recently, guidance is there?
Sorry.
That's okay. Go ahead. Common Core, you see that it has a separate page because it's the math and the English language arts. Then you have some documents that are proving to be very, very valuable to teachers. And those documents are the crosswalks and the unpacking documents. So we have had teachers to really dig in, start looking to see how the standards are different from what we have been doing. But this process, it's a lot bigger than looking at a crosswalk, because what that is it pretty much tells you where things have shifted and that sort of thing. The unpacking document is most helpful, because it gives us an idea of skills that students need to take away from certain kinds of teaching. So the unpacking has great benefit.
So can I ask one other question? My understanding is, and when I think it's the unpacking standards, when I've looked at them, that they deliberately do not put all the skills and things that a student should know, because they're trying to help teachers not just write in. It's more of an inquiry-based approach, the teaching is, so they don't necessarily put all the skills there, just samples.
Correct.
So then the teacher has got to know what kids need to know, mm-hmm. beyond just what's on those unpacking standards.
Yes.
But if you look at a standard, I think what the unpacking's good for is if you look at a standard, and as a math teacher, there were days, you know, you're thinking, when they wrote the standards, they just write them a little odd. And so if you don't quite understand the standard, you can go to the unpacking, and there's an example so that you can kind of understand what they're looking for. That doesn't mean everything's in there, but at least a lot of times it'll give you a sample where you're like, oh, that's what they're going to have to be able to do. But when she gets to curriculum mapping in a minute, you'll understand that.
In the day, when I started teaching, we had a curriculum that, as I said, I taught sixth grade math. So I would have a math objective, and I could read it and think, what exactly does that mean for a sixth grader? And it would have a column that I would have sample problems. And once I looked at the sample problems, I then could figure out what the objective meant. Well, then we completely got away from a curriculum that offered any kind of support like that. And the unpacking document helps us again. Now, I couldn't pull my entire math lesson from that old curriculum that I used to use with the sample problems, but it would give me enough to go on that I could dig, and I could find enough material to teach my lessons for the math objectives. That's what the unpacking documents help us do, and the teachers have really enjoyed them, especially some of the younger teachers who had never seen a curriculum that offered examples and, you know, students should take these skills away from the activity. So, okay, we are to the professional development. Something that has been added to this website is the professional development link. And this, like a lot of the other things that we've talked about, it changes all the time. Because today, I actually received an email that they have released on ACRE's website grades 3, 4, and 5 math units. So see, these websites, don't just think that if you see them once, that that's all that you need to look at them. They are constantly being updated with new information and new materials that are being offered to teachers. We keep hearing about toolkits that are supposed to come along with this revised and new curriculum. We haven't seen any of those yet, but we do hope that they're coming. So keep looking at the website. You'll be amazed at how much is added and how they change. And I'm going to continue on. I want to talk to you about some things that we're doing in Alexander County. For some of our teachers, it was hard for them to navigate DPI's website. So what we said was, okay, well, on our district's website, we're going to create a link for you. And that link will say Common Core and Essential Standards. And when you click on that, we're automatically going to take you to places like DPI's webpage and then some of the other Region 7's wiki. So that it's just a couple clicks away. We're trying to make as much available to our teachers as possible and to make it as easy as possible because time is a problem, as I said earlier. Now, how do you get there? If you were in our system, and you don't have to be in our system to check this out, you can do it tonight if you want to. Here is the web address for the district's website. You simply, on the right-hand side of the page, would go to staff links, and then...
Oh, it just takes a while.
It's not a Mac.
We don't have Macs either.
Did you exit the slideshow?
I'm going to have to exit the slideshow to get there.
No, it's probably behind it. Maybe. Does that make sense? Like it's there, you just can't see it.
There it is. And just for a second, I am the one who developed the site and put everything in it. I did not, there is nothing secret to the site. There are no secret passwords. You can see everything our teachers see. So if you come and we're coming into our system, you have the same, and that's one reason we're giving you this today, because we thought that way, if you all, if it's too overwhelming on DPI, you can come into ours.
Okay, on the right-hand side, you see staff links, click it. You see Common Core and Essential Standards, click it. Well, my computer just pops up.
Yeah, right.
And then over here, you see some links that we have. Here we have the Common Core and Essential Standards Core Team. That's kind of still our go-to team. And we have teachers and administrators out of every school in this represented as far as different levels that people can email, they can call, they can do whatever they need to do if they have questions about something going on. But you can see some of the content that we have here. We have the template for our curriculum mapping. And as I said, that starts later this month. Content team. We have the elementary curriculum mapping leaders, general information. Continue on down. See what we've even offered? They don't even have to go to NC Education website. They hit that link, they're there. They do have to have their username and password. But we have made a lot available to them. And it's not a secret. Anything that we find that's great. Recently I happened upon a Ken Robinson video about paradigm shifts and about how we have done business for a long, long time. And I can tell you the education system that we have used in Alexander is not working for about one out of every four of our children because they're dropping out of high school. And sometimes you're removed from that and you say, oh, well, one out of four, that's not so bad. It could be worse. But what if it were your child is the one that drops out of high school? So I truly believe that this is the time that we can make changes, and a great excuse because everything's being changed throughout the state, throughout the educational system as far as curriculum.
Can I say just a few things about the links?
But anything that we find that's good, we put up here because we want our teachers and administrators to have access to it. Go ahead.
And when we were talking about things that would help you before next year, this web blog is actually our regional leader, the state-hired regional leaders. We have a wonderful one in our region. Constantly, every day, she puts up there technology you can use in your classroom to teach things. She was an English language arts teacher in high school. She is one of the best curriculum people in the state. Go to join these blogs. Anytime you can, join them. Just when you're sitting there on your phone or at your computer, look through them, read through things. Mark things that are good that you can come back to later. The wiki for our region has all kinds of things on it. Utah Education Network, make sure you're in the Common Core for them, because they're kind of like us, they're still having old stores to study, and our new one have wonderful things. Engage New York has videos that our superintendent saw when he went into DC that are excellent. So go to those sites, look through them, go to other counties and see what they are sharing, but there's a lot of things on there that can help you.
We're talking to teachers about new things, 8 math practices that they're not used to hearing about, and what they'll say is, Jennifer, I want to see what that looks like in a classroom. So we have happened upon some videos, even from other states that engage New York. We found videos of Common Core math classrooms, and we're using those as teaching tools for our teachers. Because a lot of times with the teacher, all you have to do is show him or her, that's what I'm talking about, and if they can see it, then they can reproduce that, and they can do it themselves. All right? This has been a tremendous professional development year for our teachers, because not only have we been in preparation for Common Core and Essential Standards, but we also had to do some things with NC Falcon with formative assessments. But we wanted to give you an idea. There are 5 modules with Common Core and Essential Standards. The first one was the call for change that just kind of explained what is this all about and why are we doing it. Then understanding the standards, because all of the standards have changed. Then we're going to go to designing local curricula for the 21st century learner. That's the third one that we will do as a system. Then talking about North Carolina professional teaching standards. And if you've heard anything lately about teacher effectiveness, it's a hot topic with teachers. And then revised Bloom's taxonomy, we have some work planned with that. But also our staff, they've had to complete 5 modules for NC Falcon. So it has been a big time PD year in our school system. Teresa's going to take over for a few minutes and show you some examples. What are we talking about when we're talking about English language arts and math standards? And she's going to hit some of these links and talk to you about that.
All right, we just thought that you would want to look at a few of the things, and I'm going to have to figure out what I can say.
Well, I'll just do that anyway.
But you all, now, knowing that you're elementary, it's a little bit easier because I know exactly what you need to hit on. Many of you, especially for doing lower grades elementary, are going to have to know math, language arts, science, social studies, healthful living. Our teachers are having to pick up pieces of that. There's all kinds of things you have to know. But one of the big things in the English one is to notice that it's English language standards and literacy in history, social studies, science, and technical subjects. So not only do you have to know English language arts, you've got to look at how you have to wrap it up in everything else you do. And if you look at just one, and I'll try to go quick so you don't see it, but these are just the reading standards for literature K-5. And so those are just those standards. Then reading standards for informational text, K-5. So you don't, the least you just went through and you saw your standards. There are so many just to get you to where you're at. The College of Career Readiness anchor standards. Many times elementary teachers were like, well, you know, that's the high school getting them ready for college. It starts in kindergarten. And they make sure you know that and what you have for writing. The writing standards, separate. The reading anchor standards, speaking and listening standards, just within ELA. So it's a huge amount of things to go through and go through. Then you get to standards. So everything you just saw me click through was just K-5. And it's huge amount of detail. And this is just the standards itself. It's not the unpacking, which then gets even bigger and huge and more broad. So a lot of time spent in that one. The other one, and go back. It's not going to go to current slide, is it? The math ones. The big one about the math ones, it won't just go out and let me do that one. The math standards start. start with, if I can get to page 6 without making you all nauseous. The math standards are the standards for mathematical practice. This isn't even talking about the math standards by grade level and what you're going to teach. These standards are supposed to be taught in every subject by every teacher in every grade level. Make sense of problems and persevere in solving them. Reason abstractly and quantitatively, and it explains them. There's 3, the 4th one, the 5th one, and the 6th one. If before you get in that classroom, you know nothing else, know those.
There are 8.
Are there 8? Did I not get far enough? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. But they explain each one of them, and they expect them to be taught when the science teachers are teaching a science lesson. When a social studies person, and you think, oh, math, that there are ways, they have them posted. Our teachers already have posters up and are already looking at them and trying to implement them in their classrooms with what they're doing now.
We've even done some things with our instructional coaches where instead of having to read all of that, we have the 8 standards listed for them and then bullets underneath. What does it mean? Make sense of problems and persevere in solving them. You know, what does that mean exactly? But that means students need to be talking and explaining what they're doing. They need to be verbalizing, analyzing, planning, monitoring, checking their answers, and then constantly asking, does this make sense? So we're having to teach teachers something that they haven't really thought about before. A lot of it has just been do the algorithm.
How many of your favorite thing to teach next year, the part you can't wait for, is the math? Not uncommon. Now, coming from a high school math teacher, it's very sad. But it's not uncommon for elementary to feel very uncomfortable with the math. And it is incredible the amount of information you're going to have to give those children and how it's centered with one direction. Even within reading, going back to the text to show something. That's part of that first mathematical practice. So it's all in there. Then you can get down, you actually still have standards by grade level on top of that. So if you don't know what grade level you're going to teach next year, or as soon as you get a hiring or a student teaching job and you know what classroom you're going into, I would start looking at my grade level for everything. And again, be careful. These are the standards. We have not developed our curriculum maps yet, and when we do, we will share them with Dr. Urey, and you're welcome to know. They will be posted, actually, on our website, which you will have access to. There are already some out there. Be very careful. Some of them were not well thought. People, how do you put this nicely? Look, for example, the best thing I can think of is a book company. I've already seen, my son is a senior at Alexander Central, and he brought his literature book home last semester, and the literature book was a new one that we had just bought a few years ago. Already, it says on the front of it, Common Core and Essential Standards Based. And you can open to a page of it, and it says, this lesson follows these standards. Well, they actually have in a room like 6 or 7 people, and they're like, okay, you're Kentucky, you're North Carolina, you're Virginia, and you're Ohio, and let's look, and they'll go, oh, I think this follows, and they pull the standards in. That's not what we're doing with Common Core and Essential Standards. We are looking at what the kids should look like at the end. What do they need? What are the enduring understandings that they're supposed to get from that standard? And then how are we going to check that they have that? And the last thing we're doing in our county is saying, okay, what resources and strategies can we pull together to do that? So there are some things out there where people jump the gun, just push things into things. At the district level, they said, this is what you're going to do. Here's your pacing guide, and are pushing it out to teachers. We're trying to do it differently. Bill Gates has some English language arts guides that are out there you can actually buy. Don't spend money on those. They're okay. They're not great. They're definitely not worth paying. I think it's $160-something dollars for them. So, you know, there is lots of free things coming. Don't jump the gun and try to get ahead of that, but
I'm just curious, have you looked at the Khan Academy and any alignment between, you know, that's a new wave right now?
The only thing we've done with the Khan Academy is that we are putting that resource out in newsletters and things to parents, because with some of the children who struggle with math and the parents can't help them, we have actually suggested that resource to help out with some of the difficulties that the children are having with their math right now. That's all we've done.
You haven't heard of it, the Khan Academy is video lessons that kids can do at night, and it's a progression, the way what I saw is a progression, and you do repetition, you do a lot of repetition in there. And I was just wondering if anybody looked to see if they were aligned with the core.
No, because my only dealings has been to recommend it to parents whenever they needed a resource, an online resource, when a child's struggling with math concepts, I've given them that.
And the reason I mentioned it, Bill Gates was a big supporter of this process. It reverses education, is that you do worksheets during the day, the teachers monitor it, and the kids are actually taught at night by someone in a webinar or a video. So it's almost opposite of what we're used to. But when Bill Gates puts his money into something, it has some impact on what we do.
And
I
like
the resource idea better than turning it over.
Yeah, the only part that scares me about it, and I've not looked at it straight, is when she gets to the standards in just a second, and we're going to skip a little bit. I mean, the assessment part, I'm not so sure they can answer this question she's going to put up for you. So, the essential standards and the unpacking we're going to look at, but since we're running short on time.
We are down to about 20 minutes.
I think they need to see that assessment piece you have.
Okay.
Really
touch on this just a hair, but unpacking
the essential standards are the same. When you go in, they're going to look just like the math and the language arts. But science and social studies, for sure, if you're an elementary teacher, healthy living, you're going to have pieces of that you're going to have to teach in your classroom. The unpacking, they have it for everything. She showed you how to get there. Make sure you, when you go into the unpacking, look through, look for, well, if we go out, we'll go back in, but
sure,
in the essential standards.
I would like them to see what it looks like.
What it looks like. Mm-hmm. And you have to go back in. They changed. DPI have changed some of the unpacking already. Like they did it, and then they've already went back and corrected some of it. So let's see. Third to middle grade, right? Maybe that was arts. Not English language arts, was it? Oh, well. That was English.